Church, and welcome to another online service. Morning, Phil.
Good morning, Bradley.
Hello, Fred, all the way over there.
Good day, Fred.
Good morning, Frank, and we've got Kathy with us as well. So we're in for a wonderful morning. Come, now is the time to worship.
It's the time to worship. Come, now is the time to give your heart. Come, just as you are to worship. Come, just as you are before your
tongue will confess you are Lord. One day every knee will bow. Still the greatest treasure remains for those who gladly choose you now. Come, now is the time to worship. Come, now is the time to every tongue will confess you are God. One day every knee will bow. Still the greatest treasure remains for those who gladly choose you now. Come, now is the time to worship. Come, now is the time to give your heart. Come, just as you are to worship. Come, just as you are before your God. One day every tongue will confess you are God. One day every knee will bow. Still the greatest treasure remains for those who gladly choose you now.
One day,
every tongue will confess you are Lord. One day every knee will bow. Still the greatest treasure remains for those who gladly choose you now. Now is the time to worship. Come, now is the time to give your heart. Come.
Jesus, thank you, Lord.
Now is the time to worship. Now is the time to give you thanks and praise, Father God. Lord, we just thank you for what you've done in our lives. Lord, we thank you for what you're doing in our lives, Father God, and we thank you for what you will be doing in our lives, Lord, when you return.
Yeah.
In Jesus' name, come on.
Amen.
God is good. Are you ready to shout to the Lord?
Oh, yeah.
I am. Always shouting. Are you pumped this morning?
Always shouting, dude. Yeah.
Let's shout.
Yeah, I love shouting for Jesus. Here we go.
My Jesus, my Savior, Lord, there is none like you. All of my days I want to praise the wonders of your mighty love. My comfort, my shelter, tower of refuge and strength, let every breath, all that I am, never cease to worship you. Come, shout to the Lord all the
sing. Power and majesty, praise to the King. Mountains bow down and the seas will roar at the sound of your name. I sing for joy at the works of your hand. Forever I love you, forever I'll stand. Nothing compares to the promise I have in you. My Jesus, my Savior, Lord, there is none like you. All of my days I want to praise the wonders of your mighty love. My comfort, my shelter, tower and refuge and strength, let every breath, all that I am, never cease to worship you. But shout to the Lord, come on. Shout to the Lord, all the earth, let us see. Power and majesty, praise to the King. Mountains bow down and the seas will roar at the sound of your name. I'll sing for joy at the works of your hand. Forever I'll love you, forever I'll stand. Nothing compares to the promise I have in you.
Shout to the Lord.
Mountains bow down and the seas will roar at the sound of your name. I'll sing for joy at the works of your hands. Forever I'll love you, forever I'll stand. Nothing compares to the promise I have in you.
God, that you are a faithful God, and you are a God of promising, and you're a God of promise and a God of blessing, and we've already received all of it, Father God, because of what you did at the cross, and that is exciting, yeah?
Oh yeah, amen.
Very exciting. It is a finished and completed work at the cross.
It's been done.
Has been done. It is finished. Let's sing At the Cross.
I'm not ashamed to own my Lord, or to defend his cause. Maintain the honor of his word, the glory of his cross.
Come on, here we go.
At the cross where I first saw the light, and the burden of my heart rolled away. It was there by faith I received my sight, and now I'm happy all the day. Jesus, my Lord, I know his name. His name is all my trust. Nor will he put my soul to shame, nor let my hope be lost. At the cross where I first saw the light, and the burden of my heart rolled away. It was there by faith I received my sight, and now I'm happy all the day.
Firm
as a throne his promise stands, and he can well secure what I've committed to his hands till the decisive hour.
This will come in handy. Let me shake
a cross. At the cross, when I I first saw the light, and the burden of my heart rolled away. It was there by faith I received my sight, and now I'm happy all the day. Then will he hold my worthless name before his Father's face, and in the new Jerusalem appoint my soul a place. At the cross where I first saw the light, and the burden of my heart rolled away. It was there by faith I received my sight, and now I'm happy all the day. At the cross where I first saw the light, and the burden of my heart rolled away. It was there by faith that I received my sight, and now I'm happy all the day.
Amen. It all began at the cross.
Oh, yeah.
Now, before we sing "To God Be the Glory," I just ask you to take a moment just to go and grab a little biscuit and some juice of some sort for communion straight after "To God Be the Glory."
To God be the glory, great things he has done, so loved he the world that he gave us his Son, who yielded his life an atonement for sin, and opened the life gate that all may go in. Praise the Lord,
yeah.
Praise the Lord, let the earth hear his voice. Praise the Lord, praise the Lord, let the people rejoice. Oh, come to the Father through Jesus the Son, and give him the glory, great things he hath done. O perfect redemption, the purchase of blood, to every believer the promise of God. The vilest offender who truly that moment from Jesus a pardon receives. Praise the Lord, praise the Lord, let the earth hear his voice. Praise the Lord, praise the Lord, let the people rejoice. Oh, come to the Father through Jesus the Son, and give him the glory, great things he have done. Taught us great things he has done, and great our rejoicing through Jesus the Son. What purer and higher and greater will be our wonder, our transport, when Jesus we see. Praise the Lord, praise the Lord, let the earth hear his voice. Praise the Lord, praise the Lord, let the people rejoice. Oh, come to the Father through Jesus the Son, and give him the glory, great things he has done. Praise the Lord, praise the Lord, let the earth hear his voice. Praise the Lord, praise the Lord, let the people rejoice. Come to the Father through Jesus the Son, and give him the glory, great things he hath done.
Amen.
Amen. Hallelujah.
Amen. Now, you're doing communion?
I am, Bradley. As of, when did you text me this morning?
Probably about an hour ago.
Well, praise God. This morning's little message leading up to communion is going to be on endurance. And I've just got a footnote here. Are you a stayer or a quitter? during arguably the most testing time in our faith in a lifetime. Here are some encouraging verses that might help you, because they've certainly helped me. I'm going to start off with Galatians 6:9. So let's not get tired of doing what is good. At just the right time, we will reap a harvest of blessings if we don't give up. And I'd just like to share a little something of the last couple of weeks. There's been many a times I've just really had the sads and I just sort of struggle to get out of bed. I just feel as though I just want to be lazy and give up. But the Lord doesn't want us to do that, I can tell you now. We're still in the fight and we've all got a goal to run for him. Romans 5:3-4. We can rejoice too when we run into problems and trials, for we know that they help us develop endurance. And endurance develops strength, character, and character strengthens our confident hope of salvation. Wow. And here's one from the Old Testament that I dug up. Deuteronomy 31:8. Do not be afraid or discouraged, for the Lord will personally go ahead of you. Wow, I like that. He will personally go ahead of you. He will be with you. He will never fail you nor abandon you. We serve a very loving God, don't we? And of course, then there's Philippians 4:13. It's a bit of a modern version, this one. I think I prefer the old one, but I will quote it from the Bible I got it from. For I can do everything through Christ who gives me strength. So the strength is there for us. We don't need to get the sads. We don't need to be depressed. We don't need to be discouraged. Also, that I'll finish on a real big one, 2 Corinthians 4:16-18. That is why we never give up. Though our bodies are dying, our spirits are being renewed every day. For our present troubles are small and won't last long. Wow, I'm getting shivers with that verse. Yet they produce for us a glory that vastly outweighs them and will last forever. It's getting better. So we don't look at the trouble we can see now. Rather, we fix our gaze on things that cannot be seen. For the things we see now will be gone, but the things we cannot see will last forever. So there's some really encouraging thoughts on, when we get down and out, we want to give up and we want to quit. Okay, I'm not saying you want to quit up completely, and I don't think any of us would do that because we've got Jesus. But the thing is, we sometimes get to the stage where we think, oh, is it all worth it? You know, because there's just so much out there that's really putting us down. And what I want to lead it to is Christ on the cross, because we've got to remember that when he died on the cross for us, he wasn't a quitter. He was a stayer. He stayed right to the end, didn't he? And wow, how good is that? I mean, he was in utmost pain, utmost agony. I mean, we have nothing compared to what he did on the cross. I mean, our little sad days, our little moments of struggling to get out of bed are nothing compared to what Christ endured on the cross. So when we focus on him on the cross and what he went through for us, to just go through all of that so that we could have a chance at salvation and getting back with the Father. So thank you. We will pick up our little piece of bread, which reminds us, or biscuit, which reminds us of Christ's body, which was broken for us on the cross. Also, we've got the little glass of wine, water, whatever you've got in the fridge and you've got in your hand at the moment. Lord Jesus, I just pray at this special time this morning, Lord, as we worship you and think of you and what you did on the cross. I just pray a blessing on this piece of bread, biscuit, that reminds us, Lord, of your body which was broken to us on Calvary. Take and eat it. And also, the glass of wine or the water, a symbol of your blood, Lord, as you were dying on that cross, that all that blood was shed for us. And you didn't give up. You didn't quit. you went right through to the end, Lord. You had to do it, because if you didn't, we wouldn't have a life. We wouldn't have an eternity with you and the Father. We give you glory. Take, drink, remembering Christ's blood that was shed for us on Calvary. Thank you. Thank you, Jesus. We give you praise, we give you glory as we remember that time that you spared, that time that you endured, that time that you didn't quit for us on the cross, Lord. You endured it right to the end until it was all finished. We thank you, Father, in Jesus' name. Thanks, guys. Last song to finish on today is In Christ Alone. It's a new one. Fred picked this week. It's beautiful. It's got some great words. Here we go.
In Christ alone, my heart is found. He is my light, my strength, my song. His cornerstone, this solid ground. Firm through the fiercest drought and storm. What heights of love, what depths of peace, when fears are stilled, when striving cease. My comforter, my all in all, here in the love of Christ I stand. In Christ alone, who took on flesh, fullness of God in helpless babe. This gift of love and righteousness, scorned by the ones he came to save. Till on that cross, as Jesus died, the wrath of God was satisfied. For every sin Him was laid, here in death of Christ I live.
Amen.
There in the ground his body lay, light of the world and darkness slain, then bursting forth in glorious day, up from the grave he rose again. And as he stands in victory, sin's curse has lost its grip on me. For I am his and he is mine, bought with the precious blood of Christ. Is the power of Christ in me. From life's first cry to final breath, Jesus commands my destiny. No power in hell, no scheme of man can ever pluck me from his hand. Till he returns or calls me home, here in the power of Christ I'll stand.
Chorus.
No power of hell, no scheme of man can ever pluck me from his hand. Till he returns or calls me home, here in the power of Christ I'll stand.
No power in hell,
amen,
no scheme of man can ever pluck me from his hand. Amen.
All victory comes through Christ Jesus.
Hallelujah.
Thanks, Phil.
Thanks, Brad. Who's preaching today?
Kathy's going to be bringing the message, so we look forward to Kathy's message. God bless everyone. See you all next week.
See you next week, guys.
See you, Phil.
Bless
you. Fred.
See you, Fred.
Bye.
Bye.
Good morning to all our Southsiders who are tuning in. And good morning to all those who are not from Southside who are tuning in to our Sunday morning service. It's a privilege to be here with you this morning to share God's word with you. I am particularly interested in women in the Bible, and I've studied them for a number of years, and I think they're quite fascinating to look at. And I've got a series that I want to look at one of this morning, of the three women in the Bible who anointed Jesus. The first one is found in Luke chapter 7, verses 36 to 50, which I'll read for you. And if you've got a Bible, you might like to follow along with me. Now, one of the Pharisees invited Jesus to have dinner with him. So he went to the Pharisee's house and reclined at the table. When a woman who had lived a sinful life in that town learned that Jesus was eating at the Pharisee's house, she brought an alabaster jar of perfume, and as she stood behind him at his feet weeping, she began to wet his feet with her tears. Then she wiped them with her hair, kissed them, and poured perfume on them. When the Pharisee who had invited him saw this, he said to himself, "If this man were a prophet, he would know who was touching him and what kind of a woman she is, that she is a sinner." Jesus answered him, "Simon, I have something to tell you." "Tell me, teacher," he said. "Two men owed money to a certain moneylender. One owed 500 denarii and the other 50. Neither of them had the money to pay him back, so he cancelled the debt of both. Now, which of them will love him more?" A denarius was a coin's worth, about a day's wages. Simon replied, "I suppose the one who had the bigger debt cancelled." "You have judged correctly," Jesus said. Then he turned towards the woman and said to Simon, "Do you see this woman? I came into your house. You did not give me any water for my feet, but she wet my feet with her tears and wiped them with her hair. You did not give me a kiss, but this woman, from the time I entered, has not stopped kissing my feet. You did not put oil on my head, but she has poured perfume on my feet. Therefore I tell you, her many sins have been forgiven, for she loved much. But he who has been forgiven little loves little." Then Jesus said to her, "Your sins are forgiven." The other guests began to say among themselves, "Who is this who even forgives sins?" Jesus said to the woman, "Your faith has saved you. Go in peace." Now there's some speculation as to who the identity of this woman is. Some commentators suggest that this is Mary Magdalene, although nowhere in Scripture are we told that she lived a sinful life. We're only told that Jesus had cast seven demons out of her. Demons come through sickness, through infirmity, through frightening experiences, not just through sin or occult. So there's no evidence to suggest it was Mary Magdalene. Some say perhaps this is the woman who was caught in adultery, who Jesus wrote, bent down and wrote in the ground, and one by one her accusers left her. And then he said, "Go and sin no more." Some think this woman's coming to Jesus because she's grateful for something that Jesus has done. But clearly she knows about Jesus. Perhaps she's listened to his sermon, and perhaps in listening to him, she's been convicted of her sin. You know, every time we open the Bible and we start to listen to the Word of God and hear the Holy Spirit with our hearts, we can be convicted of sin too. But it really doesn't matter. I like the fact that it says a woman. So it could apply to anybody. And it says a woman who had lived a sinful life. You know, we all boil it down, we've all lived a sinful life. Romans 3:23 says, "All have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God." Romans 6:23 says, "For the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life in Christ Jesus." We have all lived a sinful life. Frank's been saying in recent weeks that we are born with a sinful nature intact. And it's only when we come to Christ that we get a new heart, we get a new spirit. But the sinful nature is still resident within our flesh. And until we come to Christ, we sin. The moment we break one of God's commandments, we're a sinner. And the payment for sin, the reward for sin, is death, is spiritual separation from God. So we're all sinners. So this can apply to all of us, male, female, boy or girl. Before we come to Christ, we have living a sinful life. The chief sin we live is that we are selfish. We're focused on ourselves, our needs, what we want. We're motivated by self, by the flesh, the King James Bible calls it. So we can all see ourselves in this. A woman or a person who had lived a sinful life, when she heard that Jesus was at the Pharisee's house, she sought him out. She went to him. You know, that's the beauty of it. when we realize, when we recognize that we're sinners, we can seek Jesus out. We can go and find him. The Bible says everyone who calls upon the name of the Lord will be saved. So we can come to Jesus. She came to Jesus with repentance. She came, she was weeping. Now, in those days, when they had a banquet, they would recline. They would lie on their stomach or their side with their feet behind them, and they would reach into the food on the table. So she stood behind him. So his feet are in front of her. She's standing there weeping. Now, this, for me, is a beautiful picture of repentance. When we realize that we've lived a sinful life, we can come to Jesus in repentance. And repentance means turn around and go the other way. Stop living your life for yourself. Do a U-turn. Go the other way. Come to Jesus and resolve to live your life for him, not for self. She's crying. She's weeping. She's clearly deeply convicted of her sin. And then she does something amazing. She begins to dry his feet with her hair, to anoint his feet with oil, and to kiss them. Now, this was a shocking thing for that day and age. First of all, this is a woman with a reputation. She's a scarlet woman. She's come in to this meeting and she's crying. Then she lets down her hair, which is not something a woman would do in public. She lets down her hair to dry his feet. And Simon, the Pharisee, is rebuked because Jesus was not given any water for his feet. It was common custom when an honoured guest came in to anoint their head with oil and to wash their feet. That was a sign of welcome of an honoured guest. Simon the Pharisee didn't treat Jesus as an honoured guest when he came into his house. And I wonder, as sometimes as Christians, because our body is God's house, whether we always treat Christ with the respect that he deserves. We should remember that our bodies are temples and the Spirit dwells in us. I wonder sometimes how much respect we show our God. Now, it was a custom in those days that if you came into the presence of a king, you would kiss his feet. You would bring a gift and you would kiss his feet. This woman is acknowledging something that Simon the Pharisee has not worked out yet. She's acknowledging, she knows in her heart, instinctively, she knows and she understands that she is dealing with a king, that she is dealing with the King of Kings. She's kissing his feet. Matthew 2 verse 2, the wise men that came to see the infant Jesus said, "We saw his star in the east and we've come to worship him." Literally, the word in the Greek there is proskun. We have come to kiss him. And Psalm 2 and verse 12 says, "Kiss the Son, lest he be angry." Submission to an Assyrian king was expressed by kissing his feet. How wonderful that she understands she's kissing the feet of her king. In Genesis 41:40, Pharaoh said to Joseph, "You shall be in charge of my palace, and all my people are to submit to your orders." Literally in the Hebrew, "At your command, all my people are to kiss you," i.e. kiss your hands or feet in an act of homage or submission. Simon hasn't accorded Jesus basic, decent welcome into the home. This sinful woman who comes in repentance and cries at his feet is treating him as he deserves to be King of Kings and Lord of Lords. I want to ask you today, have you received Christ as your King, as your Lord? If you have, then you need to recognize that he needs to be honored in his house. She washed his feet. Washing the feet was the menial task normally performed by a servant. To wash somebody's feet, it wasn't Simon the Pharisee that would have washed Christ's feet, it was the servants. So here she's saying, "I'm a servant to you, Jesus. You're my King and I want to serve you for the rest of my days." What a beautiful picture of salvation. She comes in repentance. She treats him as king, and then she offers her life in service to him. She's unashamed about her love for Jesus. The Beacon Bible Commentary says, "In ancient Israel, as in the Arab world today, a public display of affection between lovers is severely condemned. For a woman to flout custom in this manner is to forfeit her good name." Watchman Nee says, "In ancient Israel, public kissing between men and women, even between husband and wife, was considered a breach of the standards of decency. The only exception allowed was between blood relatives, such as brother and sister." So she's breaking convention. She's not afraid, she's not ashamed to show her love to Jesus. I want to ask you today, if you accepted Christ as King, are you open about your love and your affection for Christ? We need to be. We need to shine for Jesus. And then she did something really amazing. She gave him the most precious thing she possessed as a love gift to Jesus. We read back in the scriptures that she brought an alabaster jar of perfume. Alabaster jars of perfume were very expensive. They were one off. The jar was broken and the contents were poured on the person. So it was something that she would have saved up. This was not a cheap perfume. This was something that she'd saved up probably from her immoral earnings. It's probably, if she was a prostitute or she'd taken a lover, it was probably a gift from the lover or the earnings of her prostitution. But whatever it was, whatever the source of it was, it was the most precious thing that she possessed and she wanted to give it to Jesus. You know, our lives are the most precious thing that we possess. We need to be prepared to give our life to Jesus as a love gift. And he doesn't care, because we can give him the most precious thing we possess ourselves, even though we've been tainted or stained by sin. When we give our lives to Jesus, we become a brand new person. God doesn't remember our past. He doesn't remember our past. He wouldn't remember her past. She might have been a sinful scarlet woman, but it was gone when she accepted Christ as Lord and Saviour. The blood of Jesus washed it away. She got a new start. We can get a new start too. And if you're a Christian and you're listening to this today, remember that you are a new creation. If anyone is in Christ, he or she is a new creation. The old has gone, the new has come. She gave the most precious thing she possessed. So she's really this sinful woman who wet Jesus' feet with her tears, dried them with her hair, kissed and poured perfume on them, is a beautiful picture of repentance and submission, worship and servanthood. She didn't care what other people thought of her. She was just focused on blessing Jesus. What a focus. What an incredible focus to have. Just to bless Jesus, not to care about what people think, not to be ashamed of the gospel. Paul said, we are not ashamed of the gospel, for it is the power of salvation for all who believe. First for the Jew and then for the Gentile. The gospel. We're not ashamed of the gospel. We need to be prepared to share it whenever we get an opportunity, whenever God gives us an open door or an open heart. That's, again, a love gift for Jesus. So we see in this sinful woman a beautiful picture of salvation. We need to realize, firstly, that we are sinners. And having realized that, we need to come to Jesus in repentance. And oftentimes when we do that, the tears will flow. We need to acknowledge him as our King. Then we need to offer ourselves as his servant for the rest of our days to serve him and not self. We need to be unashamed about our love for Jesus. And we need to give him the most precious thing we possess, ourselves. Jesus said to her, your sins are forgiven. The other guests began to say amongst themselves, who is this who ever forgives sins? Jesus said to the woman, your faith has saved you. Go in peace. You know, our faith in Jesus can save us too. We can go forward knowing that we have peace with God because Jesus has made us right with him. What a beautiful picture demonstrated for this woman who was prepared to cast aside her past, her shame, and come to Jesus and be saved and cleansed and set free. On the other hand, the Pharisee had done nothing to make Jesus welcome. Yet to anoint someone's head with oil was a customary welcome, as I said before. Psalm 23:5, you prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. You anoint my head with oil. My cup overflows. You know, we have to be careful when we're dealing with Jesus that we don't get a Pharisee's mindset. Pharisees can be proud and judgmental. Luke 8:19-4, to some who were confident of their own righteousness and looked down on everybody else, Jesus told this parable. Two men went up to the temple to pray, one a Pharisee and the other a tax collector. The Pharisee stood up and prayed about himself. God, I thank you that I am not like other men, robbers, evildoers, adulterers, or even like this tax collector. I fast twice a week and give a tenth of all I give. But the tax collector stood at a distance, and he would not even look up to heaven, but he beat his breast and said, God, have mercy on me, a sinner. I tell you that this man, rather than the other, went home justified before God. For everyone who exalts himself will be humbled, and he who humbles himself will be exalted. Simon the Pharisee is sitting at this table. He's invited Jesus, but he hasn't invited him as an honoured guest. He hasn't accorded him the civility of a welcome. Why did he invite him? I read that and I wonder, why did he invite him? You know, I think he was curious. I think he was curious to see and hear this man who was drawing the crowds. I think it was curiosity. I don't think it was love. I think he wanted to judge Jesus, and he judged Jesus and he judged this woman. We have to be careful as Christians that we don't develop a Pharisee mentality. In Luke 5:29, Levi held a great banquet for Jesus at his house, and a large crowd of tax collectors and others were eating with him. But the Pharisees and the teachers of the law who belonged to their sect complained to his disciples, "Why do you eat and drink with tax collectors and sinners?" Jesus answered them, "It's not the healthy who need a doctor, but the sick. I have not come to call the righteous, but sinners to repentance." You know what's interesting? Jesus would go and eat with the Pharisees, the self-righteous, and he would go and eat with the so-called sinners, the tax collectors. Being a tax collector was the worst job, was the worst person you could be. They were a bit like the dodgy used car salesman of the day. They weren't trusted. They were rip-off merchants, and they weren't loved or appreciated. Jesus doesn't discriminate. You can be a sinner or you can be a self-righteous person. He will come if you invite him in. He will come if you invite him in. Revelation 3:20, Jesus says, "Here I am, I stand at the door and knock. If anyone hears my voice and opens the door, I will come in and eat with him and he with me." Jesus doesn't declare whether we're self-righteous or sinners. He loves us just the same. He wants to fellowship with us. He wants to come into our house. We have a choice. We have a choice. As Christians, we need not to be judgmental or self-righteous. We need not to discriminate. We need to share the gospel with all those who cross our path and we're given an opportunity. I don't believe in banging the door down or manipulating Christ into the conversation, but if an opportunity comes up to share the gospel, we need to do it. You know, we have modern day Pharisees too who dine on wealth. They say 1% of the world's wealth, 1% of people hold a vast bulk of the world's wealth. They're modern elites who dine on self-righteousness and dine on worldly wealth and want to control the affairs of men. They're modern-day Pharisees. And when Simon the Pharisee had the banquet with Jesus, the poor were allowed to come in and gather around the corners of the room and watch the wealthy, those invited to the banquet, they invited to eat, to watch them eat, and then if there's any leftovers or any crumbs, the people that were standing around could have the leftovers. And that's how the sinful woman got in there. She was coming in for the crumbs. She was coming in for the leftovers. But Jesus doesn't want his children to have leftovers. He doesn't want his children to beg for crumbs. He has prepared a table before us in the presence of our enemies. And on that table he has prepared for us is every spiritual blessing in Christ Jesus. We don't have to come to Jesus as a beggar. We don't have to come as a slave. As children of God, having accepted him as our King and our Lord, we can come and partake of everything we need. We can't afford to be modern-day Pharisees. Simon looked down on people. He looked down on those who weren't the elites. The Pharisees of the day were the elites. We can't afford to do that. We, as God's people, need to be loving and kind and generous. Jesus said to Simon, "Those who love, those who have been forgiven much, love much. Those who have been forgiven little, love little." Simon was self-righteous and he thought, "Oh, I'm pretty good. I haven't done anything really wrong. I've lived a pretty good life. I know all about the scriptures. I'm pretty good." We can't afford to be like that. We need to understand how much Jesus has forgiven us. All our sins, from the moment our first sin right through to the time we die, our sins are forgiven. And when we understand how much we are forgiven, then we need to love much. We need to respond with love towards Jesus. We need to offer our lives in self-sacrifice and service and honour him as our King. And we need to treat others the same way that Jesus treated them, not discriminate. So I want to encourage you today as we close to come to the banquet table, to know that Jesus will not judge you. He will not discriminate against you. If you come and you don't know Jesus, he will save you. Your faith can save you. And if you know Jesus, then you can come and partake of all his blessings. Let's close in prayer. Father God, we thank you. We thank you for sending Jesus. We thank you for the wise words of Scripture, for Christ's wisdom. We thank you, Lord Jesus, that our faith can save us too. We thank you, Lord Jesus, that we have been given so much, forgiven so much, and we want to give so much back to you. We want to give you our lives. We want to give you our hearts. We want to give you our possessions. We want to give you everything in service to honour you. Father, I pray as we go our separate ways during this week that we'd reflect upon these words. They would come back and we would find opportunities to show grace and love and kindness and compassion to those around us, that we might be a shining light for you, we pray. In Jesus' name, amen.